Good evening. I am Ronaldo. Welcome back to Tango Angeles. We are broadcasting live this evening from the mighty UBN radio and television network from the historic Sunset Gower Studios. Gilda was filmed right next door in the lot. The Nobel Prize-winning Czech novelist Milan Kundera writes about two different kinds of infinity in his book of forgetting and laughter. And here I will quote a passage about this from this book. Men live between the abyss of the infinitely large and the infinitely small. The journey to the smaller infinity is no less adventurous than the journey of grand infinity, and closely parallels the physicist's descent into the wondrous innards of the atom. When I read this passage, it reminded me of the two different directions or attitudes represented in Tango. One is outward and the other one inward. And when we look outward and upward, we see the stars and the sun and the moon, virtually the entire universe. And this, of course, is a grand world. This would be like the Tango Mundial champions and spectacular tango performers. Their goal is to achieve the most exquisite expression of tango, pushing the physical as well as artistic limits. And if we look inward, on the other hand, there is a different universe, a much smaller universe, or at least seemingly, and the universe within. And this universe is no less exquisite. The culture of the milongueros is like this internal universe. Most milongueros are just folks. They are not always the most physically fit people. Many milongueros are nameless, at least nameless to us, as few of them travel outside of Buenos Aires. But their lives are inextricably woven into the fabric of tango and the city of Buenos Aires. And Buenos Aires, without all of these nameless milongueros, would just be another metropolis, perhaps. And these milongueros, without Buenos Aires, would just be another group of people sharing the same pastime. So the world of milongueros is like an internal, inward universe, a world within, the continuous burrowing into the roots, forever delving deeper and deeper. The tango danced by milongueros tends to be in small steps and private. It's a secret conversation between two people. It's internal. Both the outward tango of mundial champions and artists and the internal tango of the milongueros are beautiful in their own ways. I have made no secret of which world I prefer. I prefer the interior, the private, the infinitesimal, the exquisitely subtle. But the reason I prefer the tango of the internal world could very well be the function of where I am in my life, too. I am old enough to know that going after the external glory can be wearisome and frustrating, and oftentimes not very satisfying, and sometimes even many dead ends. And I'm also old enough to know that going inward is not only accessible to me, but is deeply satisfying. Ciccio Fromboli, one of the supernovas of tango, who has really pushed the physical limits of tango, himself talks about this very thing. He says in a famous interview with Milena Plebs that as a nexus between the milongueros who taught him and the next generation that follows him, he and his fellow teachers failed to pass on what they learned from the milongueros because they, the Chichos and his fellow teachers, were crazy about creating exploring a new vein of revolution of movement. He says, as a result, his generation is responsible for not passing on the essence of tango. I see this kind of trend happening in horticulture too, by the way. Modern, scientifically bred roses do not seem to have any scent. And a rose without a scent to me is no longer a rose, no matter how visually stunning it is. By the way, today is December 2nd, and if you are just happening to be joining in, this is Tango Angeles. And today I want to talk about someone who embodies the essence of tango, as Chicho calls it. And that's Muma, Muma Valino, a milongueros milonguera. She truly embodies the milonguero culture. She was born into a tango family, and she's danced with the late, great Ricardo Vidort, also with Osvaldo Natucci, and many others. And today, we will get to know her, but even more so, you will also get to touch and almost touch the essence of what Chicho is talking about during that interview. So let me introduce Muma with a real cool milonga. And she's very well known for her sassy milonga styles. And the title of the song is Ella es así. This is the way she is. And it's a perfect song capturing who Muma is. Muma is Muma. What can I say? We'll be right back. I cannot hear the song without thinking about Muma. And when I first met Muma in Seattle, I hadn't been dancing long. And I had been learning really mostly only salon. So my first impression of Muma for me was, wow, I'm learning from a real porteña. And other than being smitten with the idea of this real porteña teacher who danced with the likes of Ricardo Vidort, honestly, at that time, I know I didn't get a full measure of who she was. I was naive, of course. But luckily, we had an opportunity to have Muma here in Los Angeles this past October. And we really got to know her much, much better. And I'm grateful that I had the opportunity. And I am happy to report that her Los Angeles visit was quite a success. And relatively speaking, I would even go out on a limb and say it was a huge success. And so without further ado, here is the first segment of my interview with Muma. Take a listen. So Muma, welcome to Tango Angeles. Empezamos a hablar.
Sí, cómo no.
Acércate acá, así te escuchan bien.
Bueno.
Y thank you, muchas gracias por estar acá con nosotros. Thank you very much.
Al contrario.
For being here. Muma has, we decided to do our interview with Muma after her trip so that she can share with us as part of our interview her experience in Los Angeles. She's been here for a week doing workshops and many private classes, and it's her Muma's first trip to Los Angeles. She's never been here before, and it's been a great, successful trip for her. She's probably worked with more than 60, 70 students, all in all, between workshops and privates, which is tremendous. And we see a great, well, let's use the term milonguero, community developing in Los Angeles, thanks to people like Muma coming here. So Muma, you've been in Los Angeles for 1 week working. Estuviste en Los Ángeles ahora trabajando una semana.
Sí, así es. Por primera vez en Los Ángeles.
For the first time in Los Angeles.
Sí. No vine antes porque la idea era que según la gente que venía no había tango milonguero y había que venir a enseñar otro tipo de tango, como para escenario, con ganchos, y eso no es lo que yo hago.
I didn't come here before because I was always told there were not enough people in Southern California, Los Angeles area, that were interested enough in the milonguero style. And that's not, and that is what I work with. Generally, I was always told there was no interest in this new style for this area.
Sí, me encontré con una sorpresa porque pensaba que realmente nadie bailaba abrazado ni al piso y me encontré con gente muy entusiasmada, por lo menos en aprenderlo y algunos ya están bailándolo. Y eso para mí fue una sorpresa muy grata.
I was very pleasantly surprised to have found a community of people who that dance close to the floor, not huge steps and theatrical performances during the social milongas. And so I was very happy to find that and meet many people that dance a style that wanted to progress, and also many people who found what I teach very interesting. And I have found an opportunity to develop many new people to dance the milonguero style. Muma, vos venís de una familia muy grande de tango. You come from a family of, your whole family's been in tango since you were born. You have a great history. We'll share a little bit of that.
Sí.
Contá un poco la historia de...
Realmente, yo nací en Buenos Aires y nací en un barrio tanguero como es Mataderos. Toda mi familia, inmigrantes, pero amando el tango y bailando desde jovencitos.
I grew up in a neighborhood, in a family and a neighborhood that just surrounded by tango. You had a lot of visitors in your home, very famous people. Mucha gente famosa que te vinieron a visitar a tu casa.
Sí, realmente la casa de mi abuela era un lugar donde venían muchos milongueros, mucha gente del tango que en ese momento no eran conocidos, pero Papá, por ejemplo, fue a la escuela primaria con Alberto Castillo y fueron amigos, muchos, muy amigos. Y también en la barra estaba el que después fue Ricardo Tanturi, y en ese momento era un conjuntito que se llamaba Los Indios.
So at my grandmother's house, that used to be a gathering place for many famous people who at the time weren't really famous yet, such as Ricardo Tanturi, before he was Tanturi, and Alberto Castillo. And my father went to elementary school with Castillo. So we all knew each other from the neighborhoods, and these were people that, like I said, they were famous. They were our friends before they became famous. And Tanturi and Castillo, for example, had their own little group that they played called Los Indios.
Sí, iban por los clubes, que en ese momento se llamaba Sociedad de Fomento. Y todo esto, no es que yo lo viví tanto, pero era muy chica. Pero lo llegué a conocer y también conocí los clubes donde iban a bailar la milonga, los sábados, iban a la milonga.
They used to play a lot at the clubs, and I was not directly involved in tango at the time, but I was heavily exposed to it, and then eventually I got to know all of the clubs where they used to go and perform for the milongas. And every Saturday night, that was our thing, to go out and dance at the milongas.
Las milongas no eran como las de ahora. Las milongas eran unos patios, eran al aire libre generalmente, donde se colgaban lamparitas de colores, y era muy simpático. Eso llegué a ver algo porque mi abuela, que vivía al lado de un club, los sábados yo le pedía que me suba a una mesa, y ella me ponía una mesa, una sillita, y yo espiaba por arriba de la pared cómo bailaban.
So back then the clubs were mostly outdoors and open air, and the little colored lights, I remember, were strung above us or above the dancing floor. And every weekend, she lived next door to this club, my grandmother, and every Saturday they had these dances, and I remember beg her to let me be able to watch the dancing. So my grandmother used to set up a little table and a chair at a point in her house next door up on the rooftop, where I could look down on the club and watch people dancing. Y después podía saber la gente bailando ahí.
Claro, me encantaba. Y además me entusiasmaba muchísimo cómo la gente se arreglaba para ir a bailar los sábados.
I was always very excited for this event, and I was so enthused, especially by the way people dressed, the way they used to dress up and come to this social gathering every weekend.
Las mujeres iban con la mamá, porque no iban solas a las milongas. La mamá se sentaba y los hombres se paraban en el medio, en el centro. Y de ahí miraban, y cuando se acercaban a la mujer le pedían primero permiso a la madre. Todo esto me lo han contado porque mis padres se conocieron antes de que yo nazca, y se conocieron en el Club de Glorias Argentinas, que es muy tradicional, todavía existe, y se conserva así, viejito como es, pero con tradición.
Well, the way it was, the young lady showed up to the milonga with their mothers, and the mothers would sit around the dance floor in their chairs, and in the center of the dance floor, the men would hang out. And when the men were ready to dance, they would approach the woman they'd want to dance with, but they wouldn't ask the young lady, they would ask the mother, they would ask permission from the mother to be able to dance. And of course, my mother and my father told me these stories also because that's how they met before I was born. They met at one of these social clubs in exactly the same way. One, Gloria del Tango, which is still open today. Even as old as it is, it's still well preserved in its ancient form, but it's still there. It's still there today.
Mi abuela tenía una casa de la que nosotros le llamamos Casa Chorizo, que ya no existen prácticamente, que es una casa alargada totalmente, donde tiene todas las habitaciones de un lado y dan todas a un patio. Y en ese patio, bueno, por supuesto que tenía la parra, donde se tomaba mate debajo de la parra, y había higueras, bueno, y había también un vestíbulo, se le decía un vestíbulo, casi al final del patio, donde estaba muy bien hecho con vitró antiguos y, bueno, una casa antigua, pero en ese estilo, donde se practicaban los casamientos, vamos a decir, practicaban, no sé, pero por ejemplo había casamientos y ponían un toldo verde arriba, un toldo verde en el piso y ahí se armaba el baile, el casamiento con las mesas largas que después se levantaban y la gente bailaba ahí.
So my grandmother had a place called Casa Chorizo, the sausage house. Because at the when you walked in the front door, it had a long, narrow hallway that led to a patio. And along each side of this hallway, there were apartments where people lived. And at the end of the hallway, it opened up to a big, beautiful patio. And that's where they used to go and practice weddings and do such things. And they used to hang a canvas above. And underneath, sometimes that's where they hang the colored lights. And then also they used to put a canvas on the floor because that way we were able to dance on the canvas floor on top of the dirt.
Yo espiaba a mis tíos cuando se vestían a la noche para ir a bailar. Nunca me voy a olvidar que mi tío mayor se ponía su traje de milonga, la camisa blanca, el moñito que se lo planchaba él todo a la tarde, y mis tías se ponían unos vestidos largos, como de satén, así, muy, muy a la usanza antigua.
And I used to spy on them while they, my uncle especially, while he was getting dressed for the milonga, and I remember he always brought out his beautiful suit, and the white shirt that and the bow tie that afternoon he pressed, and the women usually wore long dresses, usually satin dresses, and, you know, like in the old fashioned ways, and that's how they used to dress.
Mis tías tenían un negocio de sombreros donde ellas también hacían algunos de esos sombreritos con el tucito en la cara, muy simpático. Tengo fotos de ellas.
My aunts used to own and manage the ladies' hat store, so they used to build actually some fancy ones. And she, Muma says that that she has some photos that still show
sombreritos chiquitos,
small little women ladies' hats with the fishnet covering. Like they used to do. And yo veo que hoy en día se está poniendo de moda a través de usar eso.
Now, claro,
I've seen women wearing
retro,
those.
Se le dice ahora, ¿no es cierto? A la moda retro. Y realmente yo la tengo muy grabada porque para mí era como una película todo lo que veía y todo lo que el entusiasmo que ponían el sábado a la tarde ya, empezar a prepararse. Y salían y se encontraban con varias amigas en la milonga, iban con los hermanos y las madres.
I have very vivid memories and recollections of this because for me it was so impressive to see how much attention men and women paid to going dancing on a Saturday night and how enthusiastic and excited everybody was about going dancing and how much effort they put into their clothes and the way they looked. Welcome back to Tango Angeles. It was overall a very busy week we had with Muma, shuttling around between workshops and private classes. We even drove out to a little town called Ojai. It's a beautiful little town in the mountains, quite different from the mega metropolis of Los Angeles. It's about an hour or so northwest of Los Angeles. So you can imagine that by the time we finally sat down to do an interview, and we did this the night before her departure, we were completely exhausted. Muma was just got done packing, and it was past midnight. And that's why there are a few instances where I missed a little bit of the translation in the previous segment. One example is the phrase that she used, casamientos, donde practicaban los casamientos, where in the dance place in the backyards where they practice weddings. I translated this literally, but really, I believe that what she meant was that's where people used to go and make out. And what a euphemism that is, actually. You know, language used to be less direct and gentler in the old days somehow. She also talks about the La Casa de Chorizo, that's the sausage house. And what she means is it's a house with a long corridor, long and narrow corridors with lined by doors which lead to apartments many times on both sides. And last time we were in Buenos Aires, actually, we stayed in a house like this in San Telmo, and San Telmo has lots of properties like these. If you haven't visited Buenos Aires yet, I strongly recommend that you find a place like this to stay in. It's like stepping into the turn of last century. It's truly magical.
Pedazos que aún es canción. Luego tu piel como de nieve y en una ausencia leve tu pálido final.
Mamá cantó un tiempo corto con Lomuto.
My mother, for a short time, was a singer with your Francisco Lomuto's orchestra.
Pero como era muy italiano y muy celoso, mi abuelo no quiso porque no le gustaba el ambiente donde tenía que ir a cantar a la radio. Y no le gustaba y no la dejó mucho tiempo. Pero después mis otros tíos, por parte de papá, que eran tan milongueros, cada uno tenía su orquesta preferida.
My father was Italian and he was a very jealous man. And so eventually my mother stopped singing for Lomuto because he just didn't approve of the environments that she was in. Around the people that she was in, and he, being a strong Italian man, he got very jealous about that. And then within my family, especially my uncles, they each had their favorite orchestras.
Yo nací escuchando tango. O sea, era bebé y había tango en la casa.
I was born,
la radio con tango.
I was born and tango was always in my home. Muma, ¿cuál año era durante todas esas épocas que pasaste? What years
bueno,
were...
Mucho me contaron porque yo todavía no había nacido, pero después viví de chica, ya cuando Castillo empezaba a cantar, y ya casi era conocido cuando yo lo vi por primera vez.
Pero ¿cuál la época?
Después del 40.
After the 1940s.
Sí, después del 40. O sea, papá y mamá vivieron lo que se le dice la fiesta del 40, que fue cuando se conocieron.
Yeah, my mother and father lived during the... Muma calls it the fiesta. Natucci calls it the fiesta,
claro,
also.
La and fiesta del 40.
The 1940s festival, which we refer to as the golden era. So that's when my mother and father lived through the golden era. And during the early 40s, I was just a very young lady. And that's when I first heard all these orchestras, like Tanturi.
Claro, yo era muy pequeña cuando los conocí. Ellos ya habían pasado la etapa de los indios. Ya eran Tanturi, ya Castillo cantaba. Y la suerte que tuve fue, por ejemplo, de que mis tíos tuvieran ese gusto tan diferente unos del otro.
Well, it was really interesting for me. Well, first of all, Muma was saying that she, when she became aware of her environment as a young lady, Tanturi was already Tanturi with Castillo, and they had grown beyond the small little group called Los Indios.
Lo bueno es que, por ejemplo, cada uno de mis tíos, uno me hacía escuchar a Pugliese. Otro me hacía escuchar a Di Sarli y me explicaban cómo era la orquesta y que me tenía que gustar más. Y uno Canaro y otro, bueno, Castillo ya lo conocía. Y otro, bueno, así conocí muchas orquestas y realmente aprendí mucho de tango desde chiquita.
So since I was a young, very young lady, I'm impressed by my recollection that each of my uncles had their own favorite orchestra. For example, one of my uncles loved Pugliese, another one loved Di Sarli, and each one of them made me listen to these orchestras, and they would explain to me the sound and what each one meant. And in the same way, I listened to Canaro,
Troilo,
Aníbal Troilo, and I listened to many orchestras this way, and that's how I learned. I learned an awful lot from my aunts and uncles about all these different.
Este es el mejor. Este es el mejor.
And each one to them, each one of their orchestras was the best one, and they go, "No, listen to my orchestra. This is the best one." And that's how I was exposed to tango since I was a very, very little girl.
Además, desde chiquita me enseñaron a bailar, por supuesto. No se bailaba como se baila ahora con el abrazo. O sea, en la letra de los tangos de Castillo está como se baila. Así se baila el tango mientras dibujo el ocho, apretando la cintura. Bueno, ahí está el relato de cómo se bailaba en esa época. Y bueno, hacían un poco de cortes. O sea, se bailaba con algún corte y alguna quebrada, como le decían.
I was extremely fortunate that I had my family to teach me how to dance, and of course they did teach me how to dance since I was a very little girl. That's where I learned my dancing. And you know, back then, that's the way people danced. And if you listen to the song from Tanturi, Así se baila el tango, it explains exactly the way, that's exactly the way tango was danced when I was growing up. That's it. Very simple, down on the floor. That's how you dance the tango, painting ochos on the floor with your feet. And
mezclando el aliento.
And mixing the all of the different smells and the colognes and the perfumes and your hand around the waist and walking to the beat of the music. If you listen to that song, it tells you exactly the way tango was danced.
Cerrando los ojos para oír mejor.
With dancing with your eyes closed so you can hear the music better.
O sea, en los tangos está prácticamente así se baila el tango y así se bailaba.
And so when that's hence the title of the song, as this is the way you dance tango, así se baila el tango. And that's the way you dance tango. Listen to the lyrics and that's how it was done.
Y era al piso, eso sí. Era un tango al piso.
And it was a tango where you dance close to the floor with a great connection to the floor.
Las arrastradas o las figuras eran siempre abajo.
Any adornments or any breaks, any decorations were always done close to the floor. Never high kicks, never high up off the floor. Always down close to the floor.
Había un abrazo que de repente se abría y después se cerraba, o sea, no era ni todo abierto ni todo cerrado.
There was an embrace that would open and close. It was never really completely closed and it was never really completely open, but it would go between a slightly open close embrace to just a little bit more open.
Los grandes milongueros, los mejores, bailaban más apretaditos, apretando la cintura, como decía Castillo, ¿no? Pero
the old milongueros, the more mature ones, the more experienced ones, stands very close to each other, very close embrace. And welcome back to Tango Angeles. Speaking of inward and outward expressions, right here in Los Angeles on December 9th in the evening, there will be a tango lecture entitled Pass the Legacy. And this will be followed by a show by Natalia Hills and Alejandro Aquino, and it will be right here in Hollywood. And for more information, contact Tango Power at sbcglobal.net. Again, that's Tango Power, one word, at sbcglobal.net. And this event is also organized by Monica Orozco. Up next, Indio Manso, recorded in 1958 by Carlos Di Sarli, and the music written by Hector Quesada. Stay tuned, we'll be back.
everyone. I'm Ilona Glinarski, LA-based tango instructor and organizer of Milonga LAX and the LA Tango Marathon. Together with a great photographer, a lovely tanguera, and a breast cancer survivor, Johanna Siegman, we created a gorgeous calendar called Tango for Tatas to raise funds to help find cure for breast cancer. We can't do this alone. It takes a tango village to make a real difference. Calendars and lapel pins are available at tangofortatas.com. Proceeds will go to a local charity dedicated to breast cancer research. Thank you for listening and for your support. And now, back to the show.
In the next segment, Muma talks about the fiesta, the golden age, started with D'Arienzo, and how his music was so impossibly irresistible. Stay tuned, we'll be back.
Que la gran fiesta del 40 empezó con D'Arienzo, que a mí me encanta, porque D'Arienzo, muy pícaro, tomó todo lo de la Guardia Vieja y le puso otro ritmo, donde la gente no podía quedarse sentada cuando lo escuchaba.
So the fiesta or the golden era began with D'Arienzo. And I love D'Arienzo. He's has for me the best beat. And he was really quite a little devil. He took the music of the old guard that was well established and he just changed the rhythm to it.
Y todas las orquestas empezaron como a seguirlo un poco, porque mismo Di Sarli hacía picadito, Troilo hacía picadito en principio, hasta Pugliese hacía bastante marcadito, sin ser D'Arienzo, ¿no? Por supuesto.
Pero and all the orchestras followed D'Arienzo. They all had a strong beat. There was a strong beat to their music. Even though they each had their own individual feel for it, but they followed D'Arienzo because that's what became popular.
Yo amo D'Arienzo porque me gusta la energía y me gusta la alegría que le puso D'Arienzo al tango. Porque el tango era muy hermoso, pero el de la Guardia Vieja me encanta. Pero era más lento, era más apagado. En cambio, D'Arienzo agarró todo eso y le puso pólvora.
So I love D'Arienzo because he brought a lot of energy to the dancing and compared to the old guard. And Muma says she loved the music of the old guard. It was beautiful music. But it's a little slow, a little, you know, sleepy in a way. And D'Arienzo just took this and he filled it with gunpowder.
No era muy buena orquesta. O sea, Troilo tenía mejor orquesta, Di Sarli tenía mejor orquesta, Pugliese tenía mejor orquesta, pero D'Arienzo tenía la virtud de hacerlos levantar a todos de la silla y hacerlos bailar cuando tocaba.
So D'Arienzo's orchestra, really, it was an okay orchestra. It's not like it was a great orchestra. Pugliese, Troilo, they had better orchestras. But D'Arienzo had the virtue of playing music that got people up to dance. And that's what was
mucha
so
energía.
Exciting. A lot of energy to his music, and it got people up dancing. He used to get people up dancing like nobody else's business.
Y es divertido bailar D'Arienzo. Es muy divertido bailar D'Arienzo. Y en, sobre todo en la época en que D'Arienzo estuvo con Biaggi, que se mandaron unos tangos de rompe y raja. A mí me encanta. Después, bueno, el tango fue modificándose un poco con en el 45, 46... Empezó como a alejarse un poco de ese ritmo tan marcado. Y bueno, llegaron los 50, 55, con otro tipo de tango bastante más lento y no tan entusiasmante a mi criterio.
So D'Arienzo's orchestra really was, as far as dancing, they were absolutely the best, and especially during the time with Biaggi, they just ripped it. In today's terms, it would be somebody saying they were sick, absolutely sick, and they got people up dancing like nobody's business. The beat, very energetic, And then in the mid-40s, 45, 46, 47, the music started changing. And it was a slightly different sound to it, not quite as energetic. And then, of course, in the 50s, the vocals became, voices became more important. So tango changed. It didn't have the same energy as it did in the early 40s.
Darienzo tiene grabaciones de 1920, o sea, pero con otro ritmo, con el ritmo de la Guardia Vieja. Todavía no se le había ocurrido esa idea de ponerle pimienta.
Darienzo has recordings from the 1920s, and you know, they're very nice, but this was Darienzo before it occurred to him to add a little pepper to the salt.
Claro. Y por ejemplo, también la orquesta de Di Sarli ha grabado en el 28, el 29, y el sexteto de Di Sarli, el sexteto de Fresedo. Había sextetos con músicos que después cada cual hizo su orquesta o cada cual hizo lo suyo, porque hasta en un sexteto estuvo Piazzolla.
So there were many sextets, and including Di Sarli had his own, and Fresedo had his own sextets, and of course Arienzo, he did a lot of recordings in 1928, 1929.
Y Di Sarli grabó en el 28 y el 29 con su sexteto, y después por 10 años no grabó más. Y cuando volvió, ya volvió con el ritmo picadito, integrándose ya a lo que estaba haciendo D'Arienzo, que es el Di Sarli del principio que conocemos nosotros picado para bailar.
So in 1928 and 29, Di Sarli did a lot of recordings, but then mostly for the next decade he didn't really do anything, and he came back in the late 30s. Now his music, when he came back, the early recordings were with his sextet, but when he came back a decade later in the late 30s at the beginning of the fiesta, he now had integrated into his music the popular beat of the time, which D'Arienzo started. But again, Di Sarli did it in his own unique way.
Y Di Sarli para mi entender, fue la orquesta que más mantuvo el ritmo para bailar. Porque pasaron las épocas y él fue modificando su ritmo, pero siempre fue bailable.
Di Sarli, for me, remains one of my favorite orchestras because he had the best beat of any orchestra that I listened to. And Di Sarli had the unique virtue of being able to continue modifying his music as the years went by and still maintaining the beat and still maintaining danceable music decade after decade. I know from my own experience in the music that we listen to for my DJ when I do it, and also for Tango Angeles, when you listen to Di Sarli from 20s, 30s, 40s, 50s, even 60s, they're all very danceable. Di Sarli continued to make very danceable music, which was very unique because most orchestras evolved away from dancing music.
Y fue el único, creo que fue el único que no tuvo arreglador.
He was, as far as I know, the only, Di Sarli was the only orchestra that didn't have an arranger.
Sí, nadie le arreglaba, él mismo hacía las modificaciones.
He was the only one that made all of the changes and arranging to his music. He didn't have a separate arranger. He was the one who created his own music.
También lo tenemos al Gordo Troilo, maravilloso, y que fue cambiando un poco también su ritmo. Y Pugliese, que lo cambió totalmente, pero orquestas maravillosas.
Of course, Troilo, we had Troilo that was great with the rhythm, and Pugliese, who completely changed the music.
Pero papá amaba a D'Arienzo, entonces yo, como buena hija, mujer que tiene el Edipo con su papá, me encanta. Y mamá amaba a Pugliese, le gustaba lentos. Y a todos los demás, a uno le gustaba Troilo, a otro le gustaba Canaro. Canaro tuvo cinco orquestas.
My father loved Troilo, my mother loved Pugliese. Canaro, for example, he had five different orchestras. But, you know, the music of the old guard, it's not as sophisticated as, say, the music of the 40s. But, you know, it's very sensual music. It's beautiful. And a lot of people don't like the music of the old guard. They don't like dancing to it. But it's beautiful music.
Estoy en la historia del tango.
And that music is tango. That music tells the whole story of tango. That's where tango was born.
De las canciones que alivian de amor las penas y alegran los corazones. El encanto de mi ritmo juguetón fascina y en él se encierra toda el alma de mi tierra, de mi Argentina, tierra de amor. Al rezongar el bandoneón, un milongón criollo, las pretensiones porteñas de otra canción con mi compás arroyo. Y no hay mujer que de un varón resista el embrollo cuando se baila corazón a corazón y una milonga. Yo prendido siempre estoy. Mi
milonga, nací milonga, y he de morir como soy. No sé lo que es el cariño, ni sé lo que es el sufrir. Ningún metejón profundo a mí me ha de corregir. Milonga, yo vine al mundo y milongué de morir. Ayer amor me pediste, pero ya estamos en hoy. Y no duró nunca tanto el amor que siempre doy. Y hoy digo basta y me planto como milonga que soy.
When I hear this music, I can see Muma making love to the floor. You know, that's it right there. That's Muma. The last song you heard was Larga las Penas. That was Francisco Canaro and Roberto Maeda, recorded in 1935. And then before that was, of course, Milonga Criolla, Canaro and Maeda, and recorded in 1936. I am Ronaldo, and you are listening to Tango Angeles. We're broadcasting from the UBN Radio and Television Network. That's ubnradio.com. You know, the Muma, the energy she gives to the floor, it's really something to see. And the energy that she receives from the floor, it is a love affair. In fact, more than once I heard from participants at the workshops that said, came over and mentioned to me that they actually started thinking about their relationship with the floor when they danced for the first time, and that they never thought of it that way before, and it seemed to really enhance their movement and their walking on the floor. So here is Muma in part four. We'll be back.
En definitiva, yo pienso que es una tribu la del tango. Es una tribu mundial. Porque, aunque parezca mentira, yo creo que nos conocemos entre todos, entre los que vienen de Rusia, de Alemania, de Italia, de todos lados. Y es como que hay un círculo conocido y hay como una conciencia colectiva también.
Tango is like a tribe. It's like a worldwide tribe. And anywhere that you go, you meet a tango dancer. It's like part of your family. And there seems to be a collective consciousness with tango, with people around the world. It's as if anywhere you go, anybody you meet that dances in tango, it's an immediate recognition of something familiar and somebody you know.
Sí. Para mí es muy lindo que venga gente de afuera y que quiera bailar en las milongas, pero desde ya tienen que saber, acá la gente que viene a enseñar tiene que explicar que los códigos hay que respetarlos de la milonga.
It's very nice that people from all over the world come to Buenos Aires to dance. And we love that. It adds to our culture. However, teachers all around the world need to teach their students about the códigos, and the códigos in the milongas in Buenos Aires are extremely important, and you have to respect the códigos. You come to Buenos Aires, you dance in our milongas, you have to respect the códigos. This is tradition in Buenos Aires. They're there for a reason. It's there for the enjoyment of the dancers and keep everybody safe. Teachers need to teach this to their students.
Primero porque hay un juego de seducción.
First,
la mujer también elige. No es que el hombre dice voy a bailar con aquella mujer y se levanta y va a la mesa. No, se miran. Y si coinciden con la mirada porque les gusta ese tango, les gusta cómo está la pista, entonces el hombre cabecea y la mujer le hace un gesto para salir. Pero no puede levantarse un señor e ir a la mesa sin saber si esa mujer tiene ganas de bailar ese tango o si lo quiere bailar con él. Por eso que hay muchos códigos que hay que respetar, como la circulación en la pista, el no llevarse a la gente por delante, o sea, tener un ritmo y tener la improvisación incorporada como para poder evitar a ver los choques y los malos momentos que pueden suceder en las milongas.
And one of the real important códigos for us is the cabeceo, and it's great to hear it from Muma. And
conexión de la mirada.
Especially for people, foreigners that come from different countries, you know, it's a respect. You know, men come to the dance. Men, you don't just go up to a woman and ask her to dance. It's in the milongas, it really, it's a little bit of a game. It's a game, a little bit of a seductive game. The music comes on and you hear the music. The dance floor is looking good. A man looks at a woman. A woman hears the music. Ah, she sees the man. She wants to dance. It's this whole dynamic going on before each one of them. The man looks at her. She wants to dance. She accepts the dance by looking back at him. It's not the man comes and forces on top of the woman. Do you want to dance? That's very crude to behave that way in our milongas, and also to have a lot of respect for the dance floor and the way it turns, the way you navigate the dance floor. You don't pass people up and get in front of them. You avoid collisions with people. When you get step onto the dance floor, you look to make sure that you have an entrance into the dance floor. You don't just barge your way into the dance floor. Usually it's a look that men can give to each other that acknowledges that the man about to enter the dance floor is allowed, or there's a little room being made for him. And these are the small things that one does to respect each other, men and women, and to respect the dance floor.
Claro, yo estoy hablando de las milongas de Buenos Aires, ¿no es cierto? Acá, mucha gente piensa que como son amigos, pueden ir a la mesa, sacarlo. A veces yo salgo también con algún amigo que viene hasta mi mesa y me dice, bailamos un tanguito, pero no es lo habitual. O sea, el hombre que anda en la milonga recorriendo la pista alrededor por las mesas para ver quién le sale, no le sale nadie. Porque ese hombre no sabe nada de lo que es la milonga.
I have friends, for example, that come up to me to the table and they say, Muma, I want to dance a little milonga. And, you know, and with certain people and certain times, certain occasions, you know, yes, of course, you know, it's okay. I'm not that strict about it. But generally, if you're a man in a milonga and you're the type that's going around behind the tables to see who you're going to dance with and see who you're going to walk up to and dance to, I guarantee you, you're not going to dance.
Claro, a veces hay gente que viene de otros países y que piensan que pueden acercarse a su mesa como lo hacen habitualmente en su lugar. Pero, por ejemplo, va una persona que viene del extranjero y que baila tango. Se acerca a una mesa y saca a una mujer. La mujer no le sale, porque no gusta eso. Entonces va a la mesa de al lado y saca la de al lado. Y le dice que no. Y va a la otra mesa y así por ahí se recorre 5 mesas y después no baila más en toda la noche.
You know, like I said, I have sometimes friends that know me very, very well. And they know that they can approach me. But typically, that's not the way I accept dances. And so you have meaning without the cabeceo. And I see many times in the milongas that men come, you know, men from other countries, foreigners. And I see they go up to the table to a woman and ask her to dance. And of course she says no. And then he walks over to the table next door and he does the same thing. And each one after that, and they all reject him. And then pretty soon you see this guy's at a milonga and he hasn't danced all night because he doesn't understand the way we do things with the cabeceos. And he doesn't understand that that is a form of disrespect.
No
saben respetar a la mujer,
claro,
en ese
porque
sentido.
Porque no es algo antiguo, es algo tradicional, es una tradición. O sea, el tango tiene sus códigos porque es tradicional.
So,
o sea, no se puede salir de lo que es el código tanguero porque no cuadra.
These are codes that are traditional, and that's the way tango has been, and this is the way it's done, and it has to be respected. El Acomodo was composed and performed by Ricardo Donato in 1933. You know, the Códigos is, as Muma says, is not just a thing from the past, and it's a tradition, and it's the way they behave themselves in Buenos Aires, and of course she is talking about the milongas in Buenos Aires. Next segment, we talk with Muma about Ricardo Vidort. And Muma was Vidort's longtime dance and teaching partner. Stay tuned, we'll be back. Vamos a hablar un poco de Vidort.
Sí, gran milonguero.
We'll talk a little bit about Vidort.
Sí, yo puedo hablar mucho de Vidort porque...
He's a great milonguero, and I can talk a lot about him.
Gran milonguero. con una pisada espectacular, donde pisaba como un elefante, decíamos nosotros.
He walked like an elephant, the way we say it. He had a walk and a cadence and the way that he stepped to the beat of the music like nobody else.
Que no quiere decir que era pesado, sino que donde pisaba, pisaba firme.
That's not to say that he was a heavy-footed guy. It just means that walking like an elephant means that when he, each step that he took with his whole foot, and it was firm to the ground. There was no mistaking each step that he took. It was a marked step.
Para mí fue el gran milonguero porque había una combinación de abrazo, cadencia, ritmo, pisada, suavidad, no forzaba a la mujer, sabía qué le podía dar cada mujer con la que bailaba y no exigía cosas que la mujer no pudiera hacer.
He was for me one of the best milongueros because everything about the way we danced, his embrace, his rhythm, his cadence, his sure-footedness with every step. And he would never force an issue with the dancing. He would never force a woman into a step. And he would never do steps that were awkward for a woman to do. So everything he did was just simple. But beneath all that simplicity, there was a beautiful energy, the way that he brought to the dance.
Lo que pasa que él también, bueno, empezó a bailar a los 16 años y toda su vida caminó a la mañana 2 horas con el mate y por eso lo tendría tan incorporado, porque además lo bailaba con el corazón. Y bailar con él era un baile difícil, pero se hacía muy fácil por la forma en que él llevaba.
Of course, Vidor started dancing when he was 16 years old, and it's probably because he would spend at least 2 hours every morning with the mate and just walking. I mean, to the point of he perfected his walk. It was just perfect. There was no one else that walked like Vidor.
Transmitía su intención suavemente, pero claramente. Había un lenguaje totalmente legible.
He transmitted his, as a lead, he transmitted his intentions and so gently, but so clearly.
Sí, muy claro y muy suave, porque no forzaba a la mujer con la que salía a bailar, sabiendo que esa mujer no iba a poder hacer esto o aquello. Se acomodaba.
He would never force any steps. If he knew the woman, and it wasn't easy dancing with Vidor.
Un gran bailarín.
But he was very gentle, and he was clear in what he wanted to do and the steps that he wanted to do. But again, he never forced a woman into doing, everything was always very gentle. Have you ever heard of Ricardo Vidor talking about having 8 classes to teach tango?
Él no era de los que enseñaban y atrapaban al estudiante o al alumno, como quieras llamarle, eternamente.
He was not one of those types that wanted to capture and own his students for a lifetime.
Él daba clases, enseñaba todo lo que podía mucho enseñar, pero él siempre decía lo mismo. Yo te enseño esto, aquello, lo demás allá, pero vos después tenés que improvisar y hacer tu propio estilo.
Vidor taught a lot of things, but the one thing that he always taught consistently in all the years that he and I worked together is, I'm going to teach you a few simple things to do with your dancing, and then you as a student, as a dancer, have to improvise and do these things on your own and make this your own tango.
Cuando Vidor daba una clase, por ejemplo, los tenía caminando 1 hora.
When Vidor used to give a class, students, he'd make them walk for 1 hour, just spent on walking.
Le guste o no, le parezca aburrido o no, si no caminaban bien, no iban a avanzar. Entonces,
whether you liked it or not, whether you were bored with this or not, that's it. This is the basic, is the walk.
Sí.
And everything Vidort did, fundamental to his dancing, was the walking.
Yo, sí.
Pero alguna vez escuchaste haber decir algo de ocho clases?
No.
Have you ever
Yo
heard
no lo escuché. Tampoco sé toda su vida porque realmente solo fuimos amigos y compañeros de baile, milonguerísimos los dos, pero así su vida particular, vamos a decir, que todo no lo sabía. Pero yo no estuve nunca enterada de que él haya hecho ocho clases en video.
Yeah, no, I've never heard him speak specifically about eight lessons. And, of course, I also didn't know his entire life. He had his own private life. He spent a lot of years where he didn't live in Argentina. He traveled a lot. He lived in New York for many years, for example. But all the years that I spent working with Vidort, I never heard him mention to me that he had eight classes that he does tango. Now, I can tell you from our own research at Tango Angeles, it appears that somewhere along the way, Vidort had an interview where he made a passing reference that whatever you need to learn in tango, I can teach you in eight lessons. And what he really meant by that is that there are basic rules to dancing. There are several basic fundamental aspects to dancing that you can learn. And there's nothing more that he, Vidort, or anybody can teach you beyond that, because those fundamental elements you have to practice. It's a lifetime of practice. And as we mentioned earlier in the show, Vidort spent 2 hours every morning just on walking. And he did this for 20, 30, 40 years before he became Vidort. That's what he did, is just walking.
Él pudo haber dicho en alguna oportunidad, yo te puedo dar 6, 8, 10 clases, pero si vos no pones tu creatividad, tu tango, no puedo hacer nada. Yo puedo enseñarte, pero el que tiene después que hacerse su personalidad de milonguero sos vos.
He might have said somewhere along the way that I can teach you in 6, 7, 8, 10 classes everything you need to know about dancing. But what it means is that beyond that, as I said, that what Vidort expected was for the dancer to take these fundamentals and make it his or her own. You spend a lifetime perfecting these elementary building blocks to dancing, and the rest is up to you. And if you don't put your own creativity and you don't put your own feeling and make it your own dance, then there's nothing more that he can teach you beyond that. Bueno, ahí está con Vidort. Welcome back to Tango Angeles. That was El Jaguarón. Rodolfo Biaggi recorded that in 1940, and that song was written by Cipriano Nava. Jaguarón, by the way, means jaguar. And can't you see a dark, slick jaguar walking elegantly in the dark with its eyes piercing in the darkness? That's my producer's, one of her favorite tunes, EJ. Let's hear another segment of our interview with Muma. Stay tuned, we'll be back.
Y yo he tenido la gran suerte de bailar con todos milongueros muy buenos. Realmente, a veces no se da, pero también bailé mucho con el flaco Dany y enseñamos, y con este muchacho que falleció hace poco, con Arkenbaum.
I've had the great fortune of dancing with some of the best milongueros.
Con Rubén.
Rubén Harimbat.
No me acordaba el apellido.
Dany Flaco, I've even taught with Dany Flaco. Also Archimbau.
Con el pibe de Sarandí. con varios siempre buenos. Digamos que a mí me introdujo en la milonga Natucci, Osvaldo Natucci. Y él me asesoró muy bien sobre lo que era el respeto por uno mismo. Y el respeto viene también desde afuera. Si uno se respeta, te respetan los otros, te respetan los milongueros, porque a veces los milongueros tienen algunas cosas que no son del todo agradables. Pero después de todo es un lugar, es el lugar más democrático y con una estética espectacular, a mi entender.
Osvaldo Natucci was really one of the first ones to introduce me to the milongas and help me to understand about the respect. And when you respect yourself, you demand that respect from others. And especially the milongas, because milongas, I'm going to ad lib a little bit here, only because I've had these conversations with Muma before. Milongas can be sometimes a tricky place to navigate, and there are many times unsavory people that go to milongas, and they don't have the right intentions. I always was able to navigate around the milongas, and I am the respected woman that I always wanted to be and that I became and that I am. And a lot of the youth at the milongas understand this. A lot of the young dancers, they know this when I walk into the milongas, they know me.
Y aunque algún milonguero, de vez en cuando, puede suceder que se quiera tirar un lancecito, un lance, y dice, bueno, te invito a tomar un café. Yo no salí nunca a tomar un café con ningún milonguero. Se enojan, pero precisamente lo que me enseñó el negro Natucci es que se van a enojar, pero si vos bailás bien, van a volver. Vos lo que tenés que hacer es bailar bien y no con cualquiera. Y eso me quedó grabado a fuego.
If ever any of the milongueros decided to to avail themselves at me, if you will. And in the way they do it in Buenos Aires is they invite you out for a coffee, and I say no. One of the things that are branded in my heart and soul that Natucci taught me is, you know, these men, they're going to be mad at you. They're not going to be happy that you turned them down, and they're probably not going to talk to you for a long time. But if you are a great dancer and you are true to yourself, they will all be back. And this has exactly happened to me. And that's exactly the way it happened. And there were many men and that I turned down because I never went out and did any hanky-panky with any of the milongueros, and any one of them that ever got mad at me because I turned them down and that stopped dancing with me, they all came back to dance with me.
Yeah.
What is one of your happiest
moments? Tuve tantos
momentos. I've had so many. Uno que te sobresale, one that stands out for you.
Sí, un cumpleaños mío.
I had a birthday.
Que lo festejamos en Niño Bien.
That we celebrated at Niño Bien.
Que bailamos
ahora
con...
Ahora está cerrado Niño Bien, ¿no?
Sí.
Niño Bien is closed now.
Que bailamos con Ricardo Vidort. Bailamos Tigre Viejo, porque a él le gustaba y a mí también. Y
we danced Tigre Viejo, which was our favorite song.
Fue mi mejor cumpleaños, vamos a decir.
That was my the best birthday I've
ever
had.
Estaba lleno de gente y fue realmente maravilloso la forma en que la gente lo recibió.
It was the place was packed.
Y no lo grabamos.
Que la nadie lo grabó.
No lo vi, no hicimos video, no hicimos nada y fue soñado.
Niño Bien was full and the energy was high and it was just marvelous the way everybody received Vidor and we had this awesome dance and we didn't record it.
Él se fue todo vestido de negro con camisa blanca y moñito.
He was dressed in a black suit with
dandy.
A white shirt and a black bow tie. He really was a total dandy.
Y yo fui con un vestido negro largo hasta el tobillo y estábamos en una pareja que parecía que nos hubiésemos preparado para hacer un espectáculo y no fue así. Salió en el momento, él vino bien vestido porque era mi cumpleaños y había una reunión que venían como 40 personas al Niño Bien en una mesa larga. Pero ese digamos que fue un momento muy importante para mí.
Yeah, and this happened very organically because he dressed up because he was coming to my birthday party and I also felt like dressing up and I wore a long black dress down to my ankles. And all this happened very spontaneously, and it's one of my fondest memories.
Empezaron a llover las botellas de champán de las otras mesas que nos mandaban para que festejemos.
There were bottles of champagne flowing all night long, and people sending us.
Fue uno de mis mejores cumpleaños.
It was probably the best birthday party I've ever had. Thank you, Muma.
Bueno, un placer haber estado acá en Los Ángeles. Una gran sorpresa porque veo que la gente tiene mucho interés en el tango para bailar en las milongas, el tango social. Y
I'm very excited and happy.
Estoy realmente feliz.
To have been in here in Los Angeles for the first time and I'm very very excited to see there are many people in LA that have a huge interest in dancing the social tango that we dance in Buenos Aires. And I'm very excited by this to see that this is it's a growing community here. Ya está. Terminamos. Muma, it's been great having you here in Los Angeles.
Fue un gran
a compartir,
gusto.
To sí. Share with us your entire lifetime, 40, 50 years that you've been dancing and all of the energy that's in your body that you absorbed from all of these great people and then you share that with us is completely special and unique. Like finding a little treasure that we can keep for ourselves here. Muchísimas gracias,
por
tu vida y lo que
compartiste. Gracias, doy yo, y fue un placer, realmente.
Thank you. A treasure indeed. Too bad no one recorded that birthday dance with an impeccably dressed Vidor at Niño Bien and Muma with her ankle dress black. But perhaps that is how it was meant to be. As she says, it was like a dream. And I will leave it to you, the listeners, to imagine Ricardo Vidor in his dandy suit and Muma in her long black dress dancing in Niño Bien, which too not only exists in our dreams, actually in our imaginations. Let's take a listen to the song that they danced to, Tigre Viejo, Old Tiger, And this is performed by Fresedo in 1934. Stay tuned. Welcome back to Tango Angeles. After listening to that interview, now you know why I love Muma so much. I think we ended the interview that evening after 2 a.m. and we were all very exhausted. I think we still had one more suitcase left to close shut, one of three. They were all bulging with Muma's gifts to her grandchildren and small things that she purchased on her visit to L.A., like cartoon figures and lunch boxes, even a Christmas dress. But, you know, I remember that once we started doing this interview, as exhausted as we were, we all really came alive. Muma fully came alive as she was talking about her favorite topic, tango. And my producer and I listened to her with rapt attention, dreaming about the bygone era she's describing. And I think for those few hours, I felt that I was transported into another world. And I have to say this also, Muma is greater than the sum of all her aspects. So that's what we now call the Muma Gestalt. So Muma, I want you to know that we absolutely love you and everything that you are. There you have it. We're going to listen to another song, Cuatro Palabras, four words. And what are the four words? The four words are que te vaya bien, meaning may you be well. In other words, goodbye. And this is a song that was performed by Adolfo Carabelli together with my favorite dandy, Charlo, in 1933. And by the way, this song was written by Luis Rubinstein. Stay tuned. We'll be back.
Murmuré mascullando entre dientes una maldición. Que te vaya bien significa que nunca en la vida volverás a ser mi otra vez.
Cuatro palabras que sintetizan mi amargura. Cuatro palabras que me robaron tu ternura. Pero sin embargo fuiste mala, porque yo te quise como a Dios. No solo te quise, aún te quiero, así mala y todo como
back. I am Ronaldo. The next song we're going to do is a waltz. It's a song that Muma performed with LA's very own Rafael Galante. He's the organizer of Milonga El Abrojito every Thursday at the Argentine Association of Los Angeles in Burbank. You should have seen them together when they met for the first time in his studio. They wanted to see if it would work. They've never danced together before, and I tell you, it was a little like matchmaking. It was a sunny morning in North Hollywood, a beautiful day, in fact. First, Rafael and Muma talked about songs. They acted a little shy around each other, like two people on a blind date. And after going through a few song titles, Rafael held up his index finger and he pointed and he said, "I know just the song." And he walked over to his CD collection. He popped the CD into a stereo, and once the song started, they got into an embrace. My producer, EJ, and I were just watching this, and we both looked at each other because we remember seeing a smile just blossoming like a flower in a time-lapse film on Muma's face. Rafael, of course, couldn't see it, but we saw it. It was unmistakable. It was like a sunbeam. So we knew it was a match made in heaven. She was so happy. She loved his dancing, and she loved their connection. And she loved Rafael's, that little something, that flirtatious flair. So here's one of the songs they performed to at the Argentine Association in October of this year. And we'll put a link to these videos on our Facebook page. And Rafael, again, thank you. It was great what you did with Muma, just to see that happy, smiley face of hers. The song is called Pasión. and performed by Juan D'Arienzo, 1937. We'll be right back. Pasión was composed by Alberto Cosentino. Welcome back to Tango Angeles. It's already December, and I know what's on everyone's mind besides cookies and pastries. It's Christmas presents. And if you are shopping for your tango friends, let me suggest to you a tango calendar. I know we all get lots of calendars at this time of year from charity organizations. So we're all up to our eyeballs in calendars. But this is not just any calendar. Talented Ilona of Living Tango and Johanna Sigman put together a beautiful tango calendar to help support breast cancer research. Johanna's so talented. The pictures are absolutely gorgeous. And every single woman in this calendar is absolutely gorgeous. And it also has some very important tango dates, like the International Day of Tango coming up on December 11th. And so again, I encourage you to please get one of these calendars.
Hello, everyone. I'm Ilona Glinarski, LA-based tango instructor and organizer of Milonga LAX and the LA Tango Marathon. Together with a great photographer, a lovely tanguera, and a breast cancer survivor, Johanna Sigman, we created a gorgeous calendar called Tango for Tatas to raise funds to help find cure for breast cancer. We can't do this alone. It takes a tango village to make a real difference. Calendars and lapel pins are available at tangofortatas.com. Proceeds will go to a local charity dedicated to breast cancer research. Thank you for listening and for your support. And now, back to the show.
In the beginning of the show, we talked about the external grand universe versus the internal universe. Muma and Muma's tango represent the private inward universe, the homespun dirt between the toes simple tango. Isn't it great that this tango is so accessible to all of us mere mortals? We don't all have superb physiques and techniques of mundial champions, but we can still enjoy the music, enjoy the embrace, and enjoy the dance if we quiet ourselves down and listen to the inner voice we all have inside of us. The beauty and pleasure of this inward dance are no less delightful as that of the spectacular movements of the grand, external, visually stunning artistic tango. So burrow into that inner space, embrace your partner, and let the music envelop you. I believe this is what Chicho meant when he talked about the essence of tango. And let me remind you once again, on December 9th, an event honoring the outward expression of tango, featuring Natalia Hills and Alejandro Aquino. It's an event organized by Monica Orozco. And by the way, Natalia Hills and Alejandro are going to be upcoming on our show. And let me remind you, Natalia Hills is a mundial judge. So it'll be really exciting to have him on our show. La Comparsita tonight is a live performance by Osvaldo Pugliese with singers Abel Córdoba and Adrian Guida. Pugliese would have been 110 years old today, so happy birthday, maestro, and thank you for giving us such exquisite music. And from Hollywood, California, I'm Ronaldo. This has been Tango Angeles. Good night.
Thank you. conservo aquel cariño que tuve para ti. ¿Quién sabe si supiera que nunca te he olvidado? Volviendo a tu pasado, me acordarás de ti.